What's up, guys? I'm Ben from AuthenTech, and this is my camera comparison test of the new iPhone 12 Pro versus the iPhone 11 Pro. Now, this is front-facing video, 4K 30 on each. This is a quick audio comparison test. Audio test 1, 2, 3, 4. How does the audio sound and compare? With this water fountain going on behind me. How does the audio sound and compare? With this water fountain going on behind me. Here on the front camera, there's a lot more similarities than differences, and that's a common theme we'll see in all of these tests. Even the audio samples sound almost the exact same. So this is my honest and authentic review, and though this will be the unpopular opinion, I think that the iPhone 12 Pro is not worth the upgrade. And I'm not saying this against the 12 or the Max or the Mini, that's a different review. But for myself, coming from an 11 Pro, I will not be upgrading to the 12 Pro. Don't you find it a little funny that Apple stopped selling the 11 Pro, but we can still buy the 11? I think that the 11 Pro and 12 Pro are so similar that we could have saved hundreds of dollars by going with just the 11 Pro. And as you'll see in this video, it still shoots fantastic photos and videos, but I'm getting ahead of myself. Let's get back to those side-by-sides. Colors and sharpness, white balance all look good and the same. One big feature that Apple is touting is that Dolby Vision HDR, and while that's cool in concept, it's honestly been a nightmare editing in Final Cut Pro. HDR versus SDR footage in the timeline, HDR is kinda like a party trick right now. Very few people actually have the apps and displays to support this. I mean, just look, if I share this HDR video on my Instagram stories, it's blown out and looks like garbage. Until then, it's kind of like 5G, we're paying for the future possibilities. So while it's impossible to truly compare HDR video versus SDR video, the dynamic range on the 12 Pro should almost always win, we can still compare and contrast some of those other key details. The 12 Pro is maintaining a lot of those bright overexposed areas like up in the sky. In stabilization, they look almost the exact same to my eye. Is that because they're using the exact same sensor and lens here on the front camera? Now, of course, that incredible dynamic range on the iPhone still looks really great. They're some of the best in the industry. For both of these phones to keep my face well exposed and keep the details and clarity up in the bright skies and clouds is really impressive. And the 12 Pro is just even slightly better than the 11 Pro. On the front camera, let's snap a few selfies. 12 Pro looks a little brighter in most of these shots, but my skin also looks more orangey. Dynamic range sorta takes turns, sometimes better on one over the other. In portrait mode, edge detection looks similar as well, both doing a fine job of feathering the outlines. iPhone has always done a nice job of capturing portraits, and while nothing is drastically different this time around, at least they're not getting worse, both are looking good. Switching to the rear lens, both cameras have the exact same triple lens setup. I believe the lens and sensors are almost the exact same, again, very lame in my opinion. I was really hoping for a fun new camera system this year. I think all we have is an optics change from f1.8 to 1.6, woohoo. Also a LiDAR scanner, which supposedly helps in autofocus, especially in the low light, and I'll show you those tests in a minute. What's funny in these side-by-sides is, again, I'm not knocking the iPhone and capturing beautiful photos and videos, it's just a very, very small improvement in the camera upgrades, and that is why I'm disappointed. If I were to mix and match these side-by-sides, no one would even know the difference, and that just shows you how similar these cameras are. The ultra-wides are fantastically wide field of view, which I love. 120 degrees. Pixel peeping on the edges on the ultra wide, sharpness on the brick may be a tad better, but barely. Looking at the window, doesn't the 11 Pro look cleaner lines? 12 Pro looks almost oil painting effect. Overall, HDR and colors look really pleasant on both, and funny enough, when I zoom way in on the primary and telephoto lenses, it's really interesting that the newer 12 Pro possibly looks a little bit more garbled in the details. And even in this shot of the tiny text in the window, it looks better on the older 11 Pro. Now that is quite the upset. In low light and night mode photos, they each look very similar with the main and telephoto lenses. However, the one big improvement Apple has unlocked is night shots with the ultra wide lens, which is a great feature to finally have. Unfortunately, the 11 Pro can't do this yet, even though isn't that the same hardware? Couldn't this just be unlocked with a firmware update? I'm not sure.
sure.
Again, it's that new iPhone 12 Pro Max where the cool camera upgrades are coming, but very sadly, this 12 Pro isn't pro enough to warrant those upgrades. While these astro shots look cool, just wait until you see how the 12 Pro compares to the new Pixel 5. Its night shots are insane. My comparison video posts soon. Switching back to video mode, as I toggle through the ultra wide to primary wide to telephoto, these two look so similar. I believe the only other update Apple gave this 12 Pro over the 11 Pro is the optical image stabilization now makes 5 times more micro adjustments per second. I'm not sure I can actually tell a difference, can you? That cool OIS sensor shift technology, what do you know, is only coming to the Max, not the 12 Pro. Are you starting to get the idea why I feel the 12 Pro was shafted this year? Dave2D expressed a genius insight. He thinks that this iPhone 12 Pro was not the iPhone that they planned for. There's no 120Hz display, which was rumored early on. It doesn't even have that improved camera specs like the Max model, which, goofy enough, usually the Max and the Pro have the same camera system. This year, they dashed it. And the term for who's actually a pro iPhone user is kind of loose. What I do know is I run a YouTube tech channel as my full-time job, and I primarily use an iPhone for a lot of my video content. So yes, I heavily rely on a smartphone camera for my daily income. If that's not a professional user, I'm not sure what is. Again, I will not be keeping this iPhone 12 Pro. In slow motion, we have the same 120 and 240 FPS, no 960 like Samsung and others have been doing for years now. I tried shooting slow-mos on all 3 lenses, seeing if I could notice any improvements or changes, and I couldn't find anything here. Also, let's drop an F in the chat for my buddy Kelly taking one for the team on that one wheel wipeout. Don't worry, he's all good. I even tried a quick hyperlapse shot, both on the ultra wide and both stabilizations, and everything looked basically the exact same here. I ran my quick autofocus speed tests and honestly, they look almost the exact same again. Maybe the 12 Pro pulls out ahead faster by just 1 or 2 frames, but that was an inconsistent result. I dropped the lights, tried again to see if the LiDAR would help in the low light for autofocus, and it did seem to help a little bit here. Now the 11 Pro often didn't even rack focus or try to budge on my hand, which was odd. The 12 Pro's slightly larger aperture also seems to help in low light exposure, plus its autofocus was pulling faster and more accurate. But funny enough, when I went backlit by the light, ran the same autofocus test, why does the 11 Pro seem to react faster and better here over the 12 Pro? Comparing image quality on the ultra wide, they both look pretty noisy and soft. Maybe the 12 Pro looks slightly sharper in the details, slightly better in white balance as well. On the primary lens, this is one area the Dolby Vision HDR is helpful with maintaining clarity in the bright highlights. And again, that f1.6 is helping here as well. When I dip the lights way low and try autofocus again, seems the 12 Pro wins this time around, so there's that. Everything I've seen with MagSafe looks kinda lame, and when I've tried to stick it to different car magnet mounts I have, it wasn't even strong enough to hold on with confidence. And this is why I always snap on my favorite case. No, this is not sponsored, but they're from Pataka. It's a very thin and lightweight carbon fiber case with magnets built in for mounting in the car, plus it allows wireless charging through it. This is often difficult to find both features combined together. So my TLDR, the improvements made from the 11 Pro to 12 Pro this year seems so mediocre, and that's why I'm telling you guys I don't think it's worth upgrading. Save your money, just my opinion. Even The Verge says it's ahead of its time, has a lot of things you won't be able to do much with right now. And I don't know about you, but I don't want to pay over $1,000 on features I can't even fully utilize right now. So maybe it's best if you go with the 11 Pro, maybe on Swappa for like $650, or go with the standard 12 or the 12 mini. Those are cheaper with almost as good camera system, or maybe wait for the Max if you don't care about size and price tag. Personally, I think I'm gonna go with the 12 mini. I like that smaller size in hand, plus the cameras are almost the same, and if I ever need a telephoto, I'll go with the 11 Pro. Agree with me or disagree with me. It's okay to have different opinions. Leave your thoughts down in the comments. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you guys in the next one.